you've never heard the name before, it's hardly surprising, for it's not exactly the sort of place that leaps into the headlines. Ras Al Khaimah is small and poor, and as far as most people are concerned, it's a long way from anywhere. The total population is probably something between 24 and 30,000, about half of whom live in the capital. The area is uncertain, for at least two-thirds of its frontiers are disputed. Like the rest of the crucial states, Ras Al Khaimah has been under British protection since the last century. Britain looks after foreign policy and defence, or at least it used to. This is the Ras Al Khaimah Mobile Defence Force, the Arabian Peninsula's newest army. The force has been in operation since last year. It's the fourth private army to be set up along the coast since Britain announced its intention of withdrawing its military presence by 1971. Britain's been dismayed to see this latest addition to the region's Run Your Own Army Club, because the British plan was to have a political union of the sheikdoms with one common defence force. As far as London is concerned, a private army is just another obstacle to unity. But for the individual sheikdoms, it's a proud symbol of independence and self-reliance.
God for his return!
The mobile force is 180 strong at the moment, but the target is nearly double that. The cost, naturally, is very high, and is well beyond the pocket of this tiny sheikdom. Most of the bill is picked up by Saudi Arabia, which sees Ras Al Khaimah as an ally. Some help has also come from Iran across the Gulf. Britain still hopes to see units like this merged into a multinational force similar to the Trucial Oman Scouts, who built up a considerable reputation in the Gulf as impartial troubleshooters. The Scouts are British officers, and it is in fact a Briton and a former officer in the Scouts who's at the head of the Ras Al Khaimah force. He's David Neal, who at 31 must be one of the youngest lieutenant colonels in the business. We asked him how he saw his new job.
I think my own job at the moment is to actually raise the force. I mean, we're not really operational yet. And give us a year, I think, before we can really hold our own. We're forming now. We're basically getting the soldiers together, making them into a basic rifleman first, and then his other skills will follow, become a mortarman, a machine gun, and so on. And we're using the time which we've got now to prepare in basic drills. I think it's a great danger in this part of the world to do things too quickly.
How long have you been training?
Well, we've had some for about 6 months now, and they're coming on very well, and I'm pleased with the way it's coming, but it's gradual, and one can't race these things.
Do you think in any way there's a sort of competition going on between the sheikhs to get a bigger force than the other chap? I mean, Abu Dhabi have got their own defence force.
I don't think there's a competition, because no one could begin to compete. I mean,
with Abu Dhabi?
With Abu Dhabi, and it's a terribly expensive thing setting up an army. And let's remember, of course, that Ras Al Khaimah at the moment hasn't got oil. We've got great hopes for this year, but at the moment we're very much on a very tight budget, and it would be ridiculous to even compete, and there's no reason why we should want to compete.
And what about your own position? I mean, supposing the the ruler wants to do something with his force that you don't terribly like the idea of, or against Britain in some way. I mean, what is your situation? Are you totally committed to him?
Yes, I am. It's a question that I've been asked many times, and I am paid for by the ruler. I work for him. The reason that I took the job in the first place is because I respect Sheikh Sagar enormously, and I don't think the situation will arise, and I thought of this a great deal before taking the job. If it should change, well, obviously this is something that I can only decide at the time. If I was violently against it, then I'd have to resign.
This is the man Neild is responsible to, Sheikh Sagar bin Muhammad al-Qasim, who's been the ruler of Ras al-Khaimah for the past 22 years. Although Britain still controls foreign policy, it's Sheikh Sagar who takes most of the decisions and gives most of the orders. The Sheikh speaks no English, so our interview with him was carried on through an interpreter. We began by asking why the Sheikh was pressing ahead with the creation of his own force at a time when Britain was urging unity.
After Her Majesty's government decision to withdraw from the area, we found it is very necessary for us to form our own forces.
Wouldn't you rather have the Truchleben Scouts forming the Federation force?
Actually, this is our aim.
Well, in that case, why do you form your own force? There's another question of that.
في هذا الحالة ليه عم تعمل قوتكم الخاصة؟ غير متأكدين. We are uncertain of the future of the Truchleben Scouts after 1971.
Do you think that you'll be able to defend yourselves against any external threat?
هل تعتقد أنه في إمكانكم الدفاع عن نفسكم ضد أي اعتداء خارجي؟ بالتعاون مع أخواننا. With the cooperation of our brothers.
The truth is that in the long term, Sheikh Sagar doesn't really have much alternative to cooperating with his neighbors if he wants to guarantee his people's security. Ras al-Khaimah is too small and too weak to stand alone for very long. Like the rest of the Trucial Coast, Sheikh Sagar's tiny domain is a feudal society dominated by the ruling family. But the Sheikh is certainly no despot, and he prides himself on the progress that's already been made in schools, hospitals, and public works. There's no doubt, though, that a properly functioning Trucial Federation, which at the moment is little more than a name, would be of enormous benefit to Ras al-Khaimah. Is Sheikh Sagar's only continuous source of income. Stone, quarried from the hills above the capital, earns the state around £70,000 a year in exports. Most of the stone is turned into concrete molds, which are used as breakwaters. Ironically, although these are mainly for export, Ras al-Khaimah's own coastline is so badly eroded that there's talk of moving the capital to another site. Other state revenues come from agricultural exports, such as dates and tobacco, and a small but steady trickle comes from a 4% customs duty on all imported goods. More recently, there have also been payments from prospecting oil companies. Unlike neighboring states, such as Muscat and Oman or Abu Dhabi, Ras Al Khaimah has no known oil reserves, not yet anyway. But the signs are hopeful, and the prospecting companies are confident of striking oil within the next 12 months.
I think this new pattern certainly seems to be working.
Big improvement.
Yeah. The brakes have improved as well.
Yes, I think great improvement.
Peaceful though it may look, the Trucial Coast has a history of bitter tribal quarrelling and violence. In the last decade, it's true, the sheikdoms have been changing rapidly to meet the demands of the 20th century, but they've had to step out of the Middle Ages to do so. The prospect of an oil bonanza is probably one reason why Sheikh Sagar is tempted to think he can go it alone if necessary. But though it would certainly make a tremendous difference to life in this remote corner of Arabia, sudden wealth would create at least as many problems as it solved. Although Britain frowned on Sheikh Sagar's new army, it hasn't refused to supply arms to it. When Colonel Neild was in London at Christmas, his shopping list included machine guns, mortars and armoured cars, and the bill came to £250,000. The Colonel, meanwhile, is preparing to move into his new house and settle down to his rather unusual career. Does he think the force was really necessary?
Yes, I do. I think one has to prepare for the future now. 71 is only 18 months or so away.
And the British are going?
Well, so Mr. Wilson tells us. And if they are, I mean, an army can't be created overnight. And what we are trying to do now is to prepare ourselves for the future. The British Army and the TOS are being extremely helpful to us. They're helping us with courses and instructors, all things which at the moment are available. In 71, we'll be completely on our own.
Thank you.